welcome to episode 45 of Magic FM. I'm just cracking up because I play the song on my side. Masha can't even hear it, the intro song. But Masha's doing a little like song and dance, and I lost
it. I hear it in my head.
You just
though.
Know the song, right? Da-da-bum.
Yeah. So even though I can't
laughing,
hear it in my ears,
you were jamming. I loved it.
Yeah, I can hear it in my heart.
I loved it.
Soul,
that was great. I often get the Magic FM intro song stuck in my head after we do the podcast because I'll be like editing afterward. Yeah, and it's a catchy song.
yeah, it's really good.
How are you, Mosh? It's good to see you.
Oh, it's good to see you too, Gabby. I'm doing well. I'm doing really well. I got my hair cut today.
Yeah, it must be nice.
Awesome. Oh my God. The woman cutting my hair, she was so conscious of it because like she first thing she did was shave down the side of my head. She's like, doesn't that feel better? You're starting to look normal again, aren't you?
She knew. There's something about like when you get freshly shorn, you just like feel like a real person again.
Yeah, it was. And then I like to keep my hair fairly short. So once it gets unmanageable, I get uncomfortable. So yeah, I feel great. I love it. I'm super happy with all the preview stuff. I've been, because I kind of come down here in the office in the morning. First thing, I make a pot of coffee, run a cup up to Elaine, and then I bring a cup down here and I work out. And today was the first day where something from work didn't derail my workout. And I got like a good full workout in.
Nice.
So I was loving it. How about you? How are you doing?
I'm good. I have not gotten a fresh haircut. In fact, mine is scheduled for the end of the month. But I've definitely reached the spot where I'm just like putting my hair up all the time because it's like it's getting unmanageable. I'm pretty excited. We have a lot of stuff to talk about in this podcast, which is sweet. And there's just been a lot of cool games that have been out recently that we've been playing, which has been fun to play with friends. Like, I know we've talked about like Fall Guys here on stream or on stream here on the podcast. And we've also talked about Among Us. I think I mentioned that in a previous episode, but we've been playing a lot of those with a bunch of friends and it's been cool. Like, I know we're quarantined. I know that we don't get to do the things that the way we usually do. Like, I was really sad about missing GP Vegas because that would have been last week. But it's felt good to connect with folks by playing games like that. That's actually brought a lot of happiness into my life this year. So
that's good. I mean, Luis stopped the whole podcast last week. It was like, okay, I need to explain Among Us. And like, we just took a whole detour. He broke down the game. If you played Werewolf, and he gave it a ringing endorsement.
It's
so
a really, really awesome game. Like, I do think it's better when you play it with a group of friends, but it just leads to, it's the best werewolf variant by a lot, and we've just been playing it a ton, and everybody starts out being pretty bad at this game, and we're all like trying to improve our game and get better at it, and it's just fun. It's been good, clean fun, except for the part where you go around murdering people. That part's not so clean.
Or you accidentally murder someone else by airlocking them, right? That's
yeah, when you're trying to vote people off the ship, you put them in the airlock, and sometimes you vote off innocent people in the airlock. But it's a really fun game, so we've been enjoying playing some of this stuff with our friends.
What's for dinner tonight?
I just have leftovers, but I have leftover pupusas, and which are a Salvadorian dish. If you're not familiar with it, it's amazing. And then I have a slice of a pepperoni pizza that I'm also going to heat up.
I would say most people, especially in the West Coast, do not know what a pupusa is. It's East, because it's a Salvadorian. I think it's Salvadorian.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so it's way more common on the East Coast than the West Coast. And I know I didn't know what a pupusa was until I was on the East Coast. And there is actually an area in LA, right near Hollywood that has like tons of pupusas. There's, I'm going to say this wrong, but pupuserias, which sounds kind of weird.
No, that's what it's called. It's called pupuseria.
Yeah.
So,
describe a pupusa for, because I bet you a lot of people have no idea what a pupusa is.
Yeah. So, okay. So if you live in a city where you find something called a pupuseria, which is like P-U-P-U-S-E-R-I-A, you should go check it out or try to order from it. Obviously, like checking it out right now doesn't work very well, but you might be able to do takeout or delivery. It's a traditional Central American dish. I think it's primarily from El Salvador. I was introduced to it by one of my best friends who was Salvadorian, who I met in college. Mm-hmm. We've been friends for forever. And it's like so if you know arepas, which are Colombian, it's a little bit like that, except instead of the food being like the arepa being cut open and putting the food inside, it's like it all gets cooked together. So it's kind of like a flour-ish patty that is filled with different things. It might be meat, it could be pork, it could be like a mix of everything. It almost always comes with cheese. Sometimes comes with veggies, and then you eat it with this like curded mix of kind of like cauliflower and and carrots and stuff, and this red sauce on top. And that's how you traditionally eat it. And it's so good. I love pupusas. They're amazing.
So, Gabby, is there anything else you can think of that's like, you know, kind of, there's dough, some red sauce, it's filled with meat.
Oh my God, Masha's making fun of me.
Is there any other, is there any other food item that maybe our audience might be more familiar with that you could kind of make, maybe draw a parallel to? Is there anything?
Masha's like obsessed that? Thinking that all I do is eat calzones, but I do eat them sometimes. And I do end up eating them more often when we're recording the podcast because it's like a very easy thing to eat before or after the podcast. But I swear.
So you tried to hide your calzone.
With a pupusa. Mm-hmm,
okay.
Mm-hmm. It would be such gas if I just went downstairs after this and I just like heated up a calzone.
It'd be hilarious. Pupusas are great though, and I do encourage you to try them. It's someone mistakenly described them as like tacos to me, and they're just like
they're not like tacos at all.
Yeah, comp.
It really is more like some sort of like pancake kind of mm-hmm. like the way it mm-hmm. is, but it's filled and it's griddled, so.
Yeah,
it's good. Yeah, it's really good. Anyway, obviously we went on our food tangent as always. I did want to do a shout out for the sponsor of the podcast, channelfireball.com, doing a really cool thing this spoiler season. It's the new spoilers page, channelfireball.com/spoilers. Basically, CFB is just going hard on the paint, getting all the spoilers up as fast as possible. And that also includes hot takes and stuff that comes from a lot of our CFB affiliates, content producers, people associated with CFB, basically, which is sweet because you're getting some like cool hot takes about what cards are sweet, what cards maybe don't look so sweet, like which mechanics seem strong. And the CFB spoilers page also comes with an extra bonus thing. Mosh, do you want to tell us about it?
Yeah, so one of the ways that, you know, obviously listen to Magic FM and, you know, go check it out because we're telling you about it. But one of the ways we're trying to draw traffic to it, which I think is pretty sweet, is when there's a new rare spoiled, we put 5 copies on the website at a penny a piece. And it's 1 per person, first come, first serve. Go to the website. You can buy all the mythics, all the rares, 1 of for a penny a piece. So it's been, it's tough because I know there's people who are sitting there like, refresh, just waiting. But we put it out there on Twitter. You go through Twitter, you go through social media, you find it, and it's there. It's a penny for every mythic, every rare, up to 5, you know, not up to 5, exactly 5.
Exactly 5, 1 per customer, yeah. It's been cool because I've actually heard from people on my stream who have been on my stream just like hanging out, and they've also had the spoilers page on the other side because they're getting ready to try to pre-order. Because it could be any rare. Like it could be mm-hmm. like one of the best rares in the set. You just don't know, right? You're just waiting for it to come out. As it gets previewed, it gets also put up in the pre-order slot. So if you want to go try to snag some cool rares while the promotion is going on, this is a good time to try to do that.
We got tripped up today, Gabby. This totally sucked, but we're only doing it for the regular border rares. We're mm-hmm. not doing it for the extended art ones because those are, you know, more expensive.
We're just doing
the regular border rares. All the previews today for rares were extended art. We don't want to tweet out the wrong image. So we just had to like wait. So the nice thing here though is when the actual art, so it's not quite first come, first serve. It's first come when it gets posted. And we haven't posted those yet.
Mm.
Right. So we have to wait for the actual border. So you gotta kind of watch that and stay engaged.
Tuned.
But yeah. But it's really, really cool. And there are people who have messaged in different Discords. I know. I think it might have been Riley's Discord. Someone mentioned they got one. And so it's pretty cool.
Yeah, I've seen a couple people get them. And they're like, yeah, I got this one. Like, that's sweet. Especially when the card looks like it's playable and constructed, or it seems like it's going to be a pretty cool rare. Like, a lot of times the good rares, like, in sets get pretty expensive. So it's pretty sweet to actually, like, be able to... This is kind of a free roll, right? It's a penny.
Right.
You just have to be there to actually... Yeah, you have to just be there to actually buy it. So
have you followed the hot takes, Gabby?
I've been following some of the hot takes, yeah. But
have you seen the new Sulfuric Vortex? It's like 1 red, 1 other enchantment.
I didn't see that one. No, what is it?
1 red, 1 other enchantment.
Mm-hmm.
If any player, I can't remember if it's opponent or any player, casts a spell without paying a mana cost, mm-hmm. they take 5 damage.
Oh.
And then you can pay 1 red and players can't gain life.
Interesting.
And you want to know what our hot take on that was?
What was it?
I can't remember if this is the exact quote or not, but it's pretty darn close. This card is good. Channel Fireball President and CEO John Sasso. That was it.
I did see that.
Yeah, and it was just like, and it was like, we're in this Slack together, and I think Luis had a take. I said something about it, and somehow we publish Sasso's take. This card is good. Like,
great. I actually think it's way funnier that Sasso's take is the one that got published. Card is good. Period. Mm-hmm. I do remember the chatter about this card. I just didn't know which card it was.
That was it.
That's really funny.
Yeah, it was very, very funny. So, it's been a good time. So check it out.
Yeah. So about stuff for today, Mashi, there's been a lot of news this week. Part of the reason there's been a lot of news this week is because once a year, Wizards does this big announcement where they talk about what is in the roadmap. Like, what is the stuff that's coming to Magic? What are the new sets that are coming? What are new products we're working on? Like, what are we excited about? And what are the things that you should be excited about because they're coming soon? So they did that big announcement and they had a lot of stuff in it. So we're going to digest some of what we saw. And then we're also going to take a look at Zendikar Rising, some of the new mechanics that are coming out, what we think about that stuff, etc. So let's just go through the list of stuff that they had and we're just going to give some impressions for it. For the upcoming Q1 of 2021, so like I guess that's the next set.
So it'll be January.
Yeah, January. We're heading to Kaldheim, which is going to be Magic's take on a world inspired by Vikings. So that's a new one. It's going to be a new plane. Never been there before. What do you think?
Part of me is super excited because I'm a sucker for Norse mythology. Mm-hmm. And in fact, I know Luis is really into Neil Gaiman. I don't know if you've read Neil Gaiman stuff or if you like Neil Gaiman. He's awesome. I know this because I have Luis, like 10 years ago, that's not an exaggeration. I think it was probably actually 10 years ago, lent me a copy of a book called Fragile Things, which is a collection of short stories by Neil Gaiman, which is awesome.
Yeah.
And he wrote a book on Norse mythology, which is why this came to mind. So I love Norse mythology and I love exploring that. I guess there are other pantheons that are maybe less well known than like the Norse pantheon and the Greek pantheon that we're seeing a lot with Theros that I wish we could dive into. You know, there's a bunch of Chinese gods. There's, you know, Japan has gods. Every ancient culture has a pantheon of gods.
Sure.
So I kind of wish we'd go somewhere. I mean, Kaldheim's cool. I don't want to downplay how cool it is. Very, very cool. But I kind of wish, like, you know, like India has a robust.
Yeah, like, so much.
And so, a ton, you know, and I just wish maybe we explored maybe some of those areas of the world. I don't know. That's the only thing that hits me.
I think that's a very reasonable take to have. Like, that seems very reasonable to me.
Yeah. But I mean, I don't want that to, I mean, everybody loves Thor. Like, you know, I prefer my Thor's fat, but you know, whatever.
Me too.
Yeah. So that's my only take on it. I think it's going to be a lot of fun. I think there's just no way. I mean, there's no way the Norse pantheon is very, very cool. There's some great, great stories, especially if they kind of go old school because it's really, really dark with, you know, Odin one eye and the fates and everything. And if they really lean into that, it could be a lot of fun. So I don't want to detract from it, but I do think that there's a way that we could explore other pantheons that would be really, really rich and really, really awesome and more flavorful. I mean, not that Vikings aren't flavorful. They're just like, I mean, you know, you can have black pepper and I put black pepper on a lot of things and I love black pepper. I don't want to, I put it on everything, right? But at the end of the day, you can get some like yuzu kosho, which is a, you know, Japanese citrus and pepper, or just jalapeno has a little more spice to it. That's just all I'm looking for.
Sure. I can see that for sure. I was curious as to like how, like the theming that this is going to be, because I feel like kind of what you said, I think there's a lot of kind of dark stuff in Norse mythology. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering how that's going to come through in the set. And I was very curious about that because, like, I don't know, you know, the original Theros was like a pretty bright and cheery place. And then like the post Theros was kind of like this is an underworld spooky place. So yeah. I was mostly very curious about like, how's it going to come across? Is it going to be like a spooky stuff going on in the set? Or is it going to be like, oh, we're just, you know, this is all about like mythology and lore and stuff like that. So I was curious about that. Generally speaking, I'm pretty excited to go to a new plane. I think that the Wizards creative team is just really, really good at stuff like that. Like,
oh, I agree.
You know, Throne of Eldraine as a set was not great because of Oko mostly. But like, think about how great the theming was for that set. I loved going to Eldraine. I thought it was wonderful. Awesome. think
about, I want to go back.
Yeah, exactly. I would like to go back and maybe like have less Oko next time, or maybe have like a Noko that's just like unplayably bad, so it's almost a joke.
Just to make up for it.
Yeah, just to make up for it. Just like a Tybalt 2, like that Tybalt, just like make it that bad. Or like the con, you know, I think, here's a question. This is unrelated to any of the stuff we're talking about, but like, do you generally get more excited about going to a new plane or revisiting a plane that people liked?
I get excited about visiting new planes, but if Wizards went back to, like, I have my favorite plane. Like, if we went back, like, exactly what I'm talking about. If this was a return to Kamigawa, I would probably be super hyped.
You'd
for
be
it,
stoked, you know? Right?
Yeah, and maybe if we were going back to New Phyrexia, I think Merchant actually tweeted about, like, hey, why aren't we going back to Phyrexia? And my response is, look, the Phyrexians can invade anywhere, so we could have Phyrexians.
We could have Phyrexians, like, somewhere else.
right. Those could be a thing. But, you know, in general, I like to see the creative space that you get with new planes. And I mean, look, again, with something like Kaldheim, you can see like Mjolnir being a legendary equipment. That sounds pretty cool.
Yeah, that sounds, you know, really that, cool.
Somehow, like, when you attack or when it hits, or you can tap the creature equipped with it to do 3 damage to a target, that's a lightning bolt. Like, there's ways you can really, because the Norse mythology is so roadmapped and we know so much about, like, Thor,
yeah.
There's ways you can make it really, really cool and create those things. I think, by the way, just with the original query, I think you're going to have a lot of elements of light, but I think the dark is going to be there, because I think you can have the light stuff for maybe the younger audience, but the dark stuff, it makes the whole story much richer. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what they want. They want to engage that older story part of the audience, and you can kind of make it more subtle with the storytelling, so that the younger audience maybe doesn't clue into how dark it really is. Yeah. And that's the art of it. Yeah.
There is the gamut of players who play Magic is just really wide. Like, we have, it's technically a 13 plus game, so we have a lot of, you know, teenagers who play the game, and then, you know, you and I are definitely on like the older end of people who play Magic the Gathering. So you are kind of trying to reach this entire, like, this big demographic of people who play Magic. So it is nice to be able to cater to a little bit to both ends, right?
Mm-hmm.
I really personally like going to new planes. I think it's really cool. Yeah. There, you know, Ikoria, nah, it didn't really do it for me. But that's okay.
I'm with you there.
Yeah, Ikoria just was, I mean, like, I liked the set. Like, I thought the set was fun to draft.
Fine.
It was fine. I'm not excited to go back to Ikoria. Like, it just didn't do anything for me. But that's fine. There are plenty of places that we visited that I'm like, wow, I'm stoked to go back to Tarkir. Like, I can't wait until we go back to Tarkir.
Oh, same.
Because I really liked it. Or, like, you know, I never went to Kamigawa because I wasn't playing Magic back then, but I'd be stoked to go back. So I like that we get to explore these places. And, you know, if it's a bust, whatever. And instead, if it's great, you can go revisit it 3 times. Like, oh, look, did you see my segue? It was so perfect. one of the sets that's going to be available next year, it's going to be basically, I think, at the end of the year, is Innistrad. We're going back to Innistrad, baby. It's our third time.
We're going back to Innistrad twice.
Oh, that's true. We're going back to Innistrad two sets. Yes.
Yeah, there's two sets. There's a werewolf set and a vampire set. So I know I'm going to get this wrong, but it's like there's an Edwards set and a other guy set. I never watched
you, Twilight. You bricked Bashi.
I was, it's like Edward
and I didn't really read Twilight. I
have no idea.
I really don't, remember it.
I don't even know who Edward is, and my only
Edward,
context
it's
is
Edward like, Cullen. I know that. But I don't remember. Why,
all I know is Team Edward and
wasn't
team...
it Jacob? Jake?
Jacob.
Jacob.
Jacob. I think you might be right.
I don't remember, dude. I didn't read it. But yeah, so we are going to go back to Innistrad. We've been to Innistrad twice before. We went to the original Innistrad, Dark Ascension, and Avacyn Restored. And then we came back for two sets, Shadows Over Innistrad and Eldritch Moon.
Mm-hmm. And it was good. I think both those blocks were very solid blocks.
Yes, I agree. I mean, Innistrad, I think the actual set Innistrad by a lot of people is considered one of the best sets of all time, if not the best set of all time. Mm-hmm. Dark Ascension, not so much. And Avacyn Restored, definitely not. But
no, definitely
as,
not.
But as a whole, like, people love the Innistrad block, and I returned to it when things were getting like spooky with the Eldrazi and Emrakul was around there. It was pretty sweet because it was the normal Innistrad that we knew, except there was like all this weird stuff going on. Like mm-hmm. people were growing third arm, and there were like signs that the Eldrazi had been to Innistrad, or like there were like there was an Eldrazi influence. So the Eldrazi influence is probably not going to be here this time around. It's going to be focused on werewolves and vampires. And werewolves in Innistrad are really cool because they're flip cards. They get to transform. They're humans on one side, and they do another thing on the other side. And Wizards has always taken a lot of... has gotten really creative with how you treat werewolves in the game.
Yeah, I'm excited. I think that they've done a good job balancing new sets and returns to old favorites. Mm-hmm. So I actually think that they're very, very good at that, kind of like testing the wind thing. And it is always favorites, right? There's a reason we're going back to like Ravnica and Innistrad. I guess I didn't know how popular Theros was, but I mean, and I like TBD. I think it was a good set. We needed Elspeth back no matter what.
Yes.
So I think that was
good. Agreed with that.
We also have Strixhaven, which is the most, it's billed as the most elite university in the multiverse. And I think this immediately calls to mind the idea that it's a Hogwarts set.
Yes. I mean, as soon as that was revealed, people were like, oh my God, it's Hogwarts. And I think that's generally what it's going to be about. Like, it's supposed to be a wizard academy where like young Teferis go to learn how to be badass Teferis, I guess.
That was the Tolarian Academy. In my day, we didn't have Strixhaven, Tolarian Academy. Okay. We had Tolaria. And that got blown up. The Phyrexians came in. So maybe Strixhaven is going to be a Phyrexian invasion. We'll see.
There's no way, dude. Before. This just seems like it's like a kind of Harry Potter-ish set.
Dude, Harry, who's your Voldemort?
Oh, I guess you do need a villain.
Emrakul or Phyrexia. It's also like Strixhaven really calls to mind, like within the magic mythos, a Strixhaven is like an owl haven, which is very, because aren't all the Strixes basically
Strixes
owls?
Strixes are birds. Yes. They're usually owls. They're usually owls. Yeah. And a haven is a safe place for birds.
For them.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, you know, Hedwig, it calls to mind like, you know, Hedwig and all the owls there.
Yeah,
in Harry
like it feels pets. Very. So yeah, this has some real Harry Potter vibes to it. Obviously we don't know that much about the set. You make a good point. Like, who's the villain in this set? I don't know. Maybe mm-hmm. there's like a Slytherin kind of like squad of people at Strixhaven, and they're the villains.
That's not exciting. We can do better than that. We can do better than that.
I don't know. Somebody's attacking Strixhaven and everyone's teaming up against them? Question mark?
Yeah. So someone called Phyrexia.
We're not going to see Phyrexians here. There's no way.
Why not?
There's no way.
They've let Phyrexia alone. I mean, we don't know what's happening on New Phyrexia right now.
No, like, we don't.
The Phyrexians are there, and they're not going to just stick to one plane. They are going to look. I'll tell you what. If Karn is a professor at Strixhaven, which he almost certainly is,
he probably
know there's
is.
Professor Karn.
He probably is. Yes.
He's kind of the Hagrid, right? Karn is Hagrid, and immediately you know, like, okay, and then like, what is Teferi Dumbledore in this scenario? Like, trust me, the Phyrexians are coming.
It would be kind of cool if Teferi were the professor there, just like teaching young time mages how to do time mage things.
Well, Urza was a professor at Tolarian Academy. Baron Urza Rain Academy Chancellor, and Teferi was a student. Disruptive student. Is
right.
Teferi.
So it would be cool if he becomes like the teacher, right? Because now mm-hmm. he's the one that's alive, and everyone else has been a long time.
I'm calling it right now. Phyrexians.
All right. I'm going to take the under on that. And I think the set's going to be about a magic school with some sort of evil character that's like a planeswalker whose spark ignited because they were in the school and something traumatic happened.
All right. And their name was Tom something.
Yes, I was going to say.
Like
and
it's like an anagram. Oh my God.
Yeah, but I actually think it sounds pretty cool as a set. Like it's mm-hmm. less about the fact that we're going to go to a plane, and it's more about being at like a school, which I think gives them a lot of, I don't know, gives them a lot of like creative freedom to do some interesting cards and mechanics.
Yeah. Yeah. And I mean, I know it's a little bit out of flavor to be a Harry Potter fan, and I don't want to dive into that, but I certainly, when I discovered that universe, fell in love with it. And I think that it's been say what you want about J.K. Rowling, those books have been an amazing way to engage young readers and a young audience.
Yeah, I got a whole specifically generation reading in again. Mm-hmm. I agree.
And that's been powerful. And maybe we get a little bit of that here with Strixhaven. We can engage that young audience into joining our community, playing Magic.
I like it.
Yeah.
And then there is another And this is honestly, I don't know if this is the one I'm most excited about, because I'm actually quite excited about a lot of these. Like, probably in order, the Innistrad is the one I'm most excited about. I'm very excited to go back to Innistrad, but this one is probably my second pick. This set is going to replace what would have been the core set next year, and it's going to be called Adventures in the Forgotten Realms, and it's the first Dungeons & Dragons-themed magic set. It's going to take place of the core set.
It's a really, really long name, Adventures in the Forgotten Realms.
Yes, I agree. I don't know why they... Like, well, what's gonna be the set name for this? Like, EITFR?
AFR. It's gonna MTG. MTGAFR.
Yeah, probably.
I don't know. I guess Forgotten Realms is a D&D copyright, right? So they want...
I'm sure they wanted a name that was D&D related.
And why don't they just call it Forgotten Realms?
I don't know. Maybe it was part of them getting the IP or something. I mean, they're the same company.
Yeah, I mean, because like, think of it like this. You can add adventures into any set. Adventures in Kaldheim. Adventures in Strixhaven or at Strixhaven.
Yes. In Strixhaven? Of Strixhaven.
Yeah. At Strixhaven. I mean,
at Strixhaven, I think.
Yeah. Adventures in Zendikar Rising. Like, it's so stupid to add that in there. It doesn't make any sense. Just call it Forgotten Realms, for God's sake. But I'm excited about this. Although, here's a question, Gabby. Mm-hmm. And I know we're gonna talk about the mechanics of Zendikar Rising. But it was this announcement kind of, I was a bit befuddled because it feels like this set is very D&D themed with the party, the cleric, the wizard, the warrior.
I was confused about that too, because yes, one of the mechanics in this set is that basically it's called party, and we'll talk about party, which I actually think sounds cool. It sounds like a cool mechanic, but that's just what I would have expected to see in this set. Remember though, this is going to take place this is going to take over what the core set would have been. And core sets, generally speaking, tend to be a lot less complicated. They have less, I mean, I don't want to say depth, but they tend to have less mechanics. They tend to have mm-hmm. less confusing stuff. The whole point of the core set is to make an entryway for somebody who's not super familiar to magic to start playing. And then you're more likely to find creatures like giant spider and evergreen keywords than complicated mechanics like evolve, like you see in Ikoria or something. So there's a chance they introduce this mechanic now for that to be kind of a thing that they do in that set. I could see that option.
It's a pretty complex mechanic though.
Is it?
Having to keep track as a new player, like, wait, what does this spell cost? Wait, okay, I've got this zombie cleric and this wizard warrior. Wait a minute, is it a wizard and a warrior, or is it a wizard or a warrior? Well, it turns out it has to be a wizard or a warrior. You can't double count it. So I think it's a little, I mean, I had questions about party and how party worked.
Yeah, of course. I mean, I'm not saying it's like the simplest mechanic ever. It's not like flying, right? That's like pretty straightforward thing. But it feels to me like trying to count the party members, like how many different party members you have. Yes, there's a little bit of bookkeeping, but also like, there's a list of these are the four characters that you care about. Like, these are the four classes you care about. And like, that's all you need to care about. And if you get there, great. And if you don't, you don't. So I just have a hard time not seeing that mechanic in the D&D set. Like, it doesn't make any sense.
I think it has to be in there. I wonder if this is going to have that kind of traditional break into magic vibe to it. Because if they keep doing jump starts, I don't think they need that out of that core set thing anymore.
I kind of agree that, I mean... So we went through an entire period where core sets were killed for like, what, 2.5 years maybe?
Yeah.
Magic Origins to M21? No, M20.
No, those M20.
M20.
M20, yeah.
So there were like a good amount of years in there without core sets. And I think initially they were taking out because people were saying, core set's kind of boring. I don't like it.
Yeah.
It's not as exciting as the normal sets. But then eventually I think what Wizards came back and said was, hey, we realized that this was one of the best ways for people to get into magic. So they did surface something like that. I don't know what all the reasoning was to bring the core set back, but they did say like, hey, we did feel like this was a good entryway for people. That said, what you mentioned, Jumpstart kind of is supposed to do the same thing too. And I think it was pretty successful at doing that. I don't know if they're going to keep running it, but it seems to me like it went over pretty well.
I think that It's also a very good way, having a core set, to get those reprints into standard that you think are going to be good in standard. Like, I think it's a very good vehicle for that. And you can do that kind of en masse. So I think that's an important thing to keep in mind.
I think they did a pretty good job. I think Wizards did a pretty good job putting cards into Arena through Jumpstart too. Like, it was an interesting way of adding cards to, like, in a different setting than the Historic Anthology, because I think we kind of talked about this. If they just keep doing Historic Anthologies over and over again, like, people are just going to be like, man, this just feels like they're trying to, like, rake me so that I buy every Historic Anthology. But Jumpstart was a set that you could play. You could draft it and stuff. So that's an easier way of getting, like, the cards out in circulation.
Just keep doing those remastered sets. I am loving Amonkhet Remastered.
I knew, like, you were going to like Amonkhet. That set is like all attack. You would love it. Gus Walker exert again.
Can I tell you though, a draft is so funny because I drafted a deck, a red white deck that I thought was just like, no one wants to hear your bad beats, but I thought it was just an amazing deck. And I go 3-3 with it. I was just like, what the heck happened? So then I rage drafted. And at the end of the draft, I was like, the wheels just totally fell off this deck. What the hell was I thinking? Oh my God. And I'm like 5-0 with it. Like, it's just I don't understand this format at all.
I remember when I first started playing Magic, I just always felt this way. I would go to FNM and every time I drafted a deck that I was like, man, this deck is a banger. Like, I love it. I'm going to crush with this one. Easy 3-0. Always like 1-2 and 0-3. And then I would just draft a deck that I was like, wow, this deck didn't come together. I didn't have a plan. I don't feel like I read the signals. I didn't end up in the right colors. I didn't end up with a single rare. And then it just like 3-0 with it. And it always happened. And I don't know why. I know it's biased. Like, I know I'm like looking for that. But I felt like it always was happening, especially when I was going to FNM.
Yeah. I mean, so I have a horrible story. I never talk to people about how good my deck is at FNM because there was a guy we used to work with. And he ended up, I firmly believe this is why he hated me, because he always hated me. In fact, he once gave a whole speech about how he hated me.
Oh my God.
And Luis knows who it is. And we were playing at FNM and I had drafted a horrible deck, but I had a bomb. And I think it was like destroy all creatures. I can't remember what the card did. It was like destroy all creatures. For every creature destroyed this way, put a 1/1 spirit token in the play, right?
Wow. Was
it not Marshall Coup? Marshall Coup?
That sounds like,
yeah, I think,
it makes a 1/1 soldier though, I think.
Okay, I think that's what it was. Yeah. And that was like the only, that's why I drafted. I started, it was like my pack one, pick one, and I got it. And I tried to do 5-color. It was terrible. And game one, my opponent plays right into it and I just destroy him. Right. I kept saying, because like, I knew him, we worked together, and I was like, oh yeah, my deck's really bad. The wheels fell off. And then I wrath him out and just crush him. And so he was a little bit tilted, and I was like, yeah, that's like the bomb in my deck. Right. And then game two, he like just vomits his creatures on the board, like, and totally just plays cast into Marshall it, Kirk. And I draw it, and I wrath, and he like just grabbed his cards and went storming out of the store, and I was just like, oh no, the deck was bad though. So I never tell people, oh, I think my deck is bad or anything.
I will say that is like somewhat BM, like. It's not that different. I'm sure you remember this in school when people go like, oh, I totally flunked that test. Like, I didn't study. Yeah, yeah. I totally flunked it. I definitely got all these answers wrong now that we're comparing notes. And then like a week later, you get your test results back and that person aced it. And you're like out here with like, okay, well, I didn't claim that I flunked the test, but I definitely didn't get like a 95 like this other person.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's so similar when people do that with their decks and they're like, or when people apologize at the end of the match and they're like, I'm sorry, I don't know how I beat you. My deck was so bad. It's like, I don't want to hear that.
Yeah, that is awful. Like, please, you're just twisting it.
I know I lost. It's fine. It's fine that I lost. Yeah. But I don't need to hear about how like bad you played or how bad your deck was because I couldn't beat your deck. Like, I don't need it. You're just salting the wound.
Yeah. So yeah, I that is my rule now. Though I never just, I mean, if I'm playing with you or something,
right? Like, that's different though. Yeah. I just like when you're playing with a random person, you just don't want to go up to them and be like, "Wow, I totally punted against you too. Wow, that was embarrassing."
All right. So we have a D&D themed set. I don't play D&D, Gabby. So do you have any insight, like any predictions about what that could mean? I mean, the party mechanic is already out there. So
I thought it was going to be like the party mechanic. One of the things that I thought was pretty cool is. So I was like reading at like people's reactions for specifically the D&D set, because I mean, you know, the D&D like folks are rabid fans, like myself included. And so people were saying like, this is such a cool opportunity to like, people were basically saying like, can we do this every time for the corset instead of the normal corset? Because there's just so much to be explored within the D&D realm. There's all these really iconic creatures. There's all these really iconic spells. And one of the things that's actually kind of tricky is that a lot of the spells and creatures that you see in D&D are very basic, because this is where a lot of other places took their inspiration from.
Like, it's where Magic the Gathering took its inspiration from.
And stuff like Lightning Bolt, Fire Bolt, they're some of the best like spells in D&D, and it's because that's where they originated from. But if you just hear that in like a Magic card, you're like, oh, Lightning Bolt, like very clever. Like that's just Bolt. Like that's been around for forever. Or Fire Bolt, like there's a Firebolt also. So it's going to be interesting how they balance like the cool, exciting stuff from D&D and the iconic stuff from D&D, because so much of it is going to be like kind of basic.
And, you know, I think that I didn't know there was a clamoring for this, but I was actually going to ask this, like, because of those fun, I agree with everything you just said completely. And so I just wonder if they're like, yeah, we're not doing a core set, we're just doing a D&D theme set, but a D&D theme set can be very basic and really function like a core set. So, you know, it could, I could see them doing their D&D. They have the IP. They might as well market it, make that the core set. And there's been this massive renaissance, right? Like, I wonder, what do you think took them so long to make this D&D set?
I have no idea. It seems like a no-brainer to me. And I've heard so many people ask for this over so many years that it's just like, finally, we're going to get the D&D set. I don't really know why it took so long. It seems like such a slam dunk.
Well, I could see it. The popularity of D&D is very niche, and it's been very, very niche for a long time. Mm-hmm. But it's had this huge renaissance.
It's gotten super popular in the last few years.
Because of Stranger Things. Stranger Things
is a big part of it, but there has been D&D requires a lot of setup to play. Like that's the like biggest downside of it, is you need to have a DM who's doing the whole thing, and it just can be cumbersome. There are so many tools out now that make it a lot easier to play D&D, like D&D Beyond and a lot of extensions that you just put in browser, that instead of having to calculate like, all right, I'm going to roll for whatever, and then I'm going to do my check and then compare it to your thing, and I add my modifier, and then I have proficiency in it. Like all of that is like, my gosh, that's like so much stuff to keep track of. Whereas when you do it on your computer, it just like does it all automatically for you. So I think that's made it a lot more accessible too.
Nice. Yeah. I just figured with Stranger Things, they would have rushed something like this out. Now, though, Gabby, it's probably a good time for our weekly Yaka checkup. How are things with Yaka?
So Yaka is this skull that is in our D&D campaign. And it's basically just Luis in our campaign, who's our DM. Yaka's doing okay. He still mocks us, but he...
We haven't figured out how to stop him, huh?
Not really. But Yaka was very impressed because we defeated a beholder. A beholder is like one of the like iconic creatures that are in D&D. And actually, when I was like reading people's reactions of like the D&D set, people were like, if you don't give us beholder, like we're going to be really mad. Like I will not buy the set if we don't get a beholder.
Wow.
It's just like such an iconic creature in the lore. And there's so much creative stuff you can do, because like people were saying like the beholder is this like monster with all eyes. And one of its central eyes basically like gives it kind of what hexproof would be. So people were like, yeah, like it just like probably it needs to have like hexproof and stuff like that. So people were like trying to figure out like what would the design for a beholder be for a Magic card. So Yaka was impressed that we actually managed to beat a beholder, but we kind of cheesed it. We put it into like an extra dimensional space and made it disappear.
Whatever. Oh, yeah. Take the W.
Oh, yeah.
Just take the W.
We really did. We were very happy. Yeah. Luis expected that two of us would die if we actually fought it, and we just clean killed it like that. It was nice.
Nice. Nice. I will say that I don't know about a beholder, but I think we're basically guaranteed a Demogorgon, right? That just has to
be. Yes. I mean, I would be surprised if we didn't have something like that. We're just going to see a lot of the traditional like mythic characters. Like we're going to see, I would be surprised if we didn't see like Medusas, or we didn't see like, God, I forget the name, but it's like the things that always look like a treasure chest. And then when you go touch them, they actually like are not treasure chests. They always bite you. I'm forgetting the name, but it happens all the time because people are like, oh, look, a cool treasure chest. Go try to open it and it bites you.
Don't touch it. No, but the Demogorgon is the Stranger Things. That's they keep calling that thing. Yeah. So I feel like there's got to be some motivation for that. Get that crossover. I think this is a great move. Like, I'm 100% behind this. I think this is awesome. Super overdue. So I'm happy. And this roadmap in general just feels awesome. Like you said, like,
yes,
you started ranking it. I'm like, I don't even know what my ranking is. Like, it's very exciting here.
Yeah, I think I'm excited in order. Innistrad, D&D set. Maybe D&D set above. I'm not sure. Innistrad, D&D set, Strixhaven, and then Kaldheim. But it's a very small gap between all of them. Like, mm-hmm. I remember the roadmap last time. The roadmap last time sounded like a joke because we had been playing sets with Teferi for like an entire year. And then the announcer was like, hey, by the way, do you remember Teferi? Because we're going to go to a Teferi theme set. And that was the core set.
And it was just like,
ugh. It was like, oh, read the room.
Yeah, I would go, let's see, I would go, honestly, I'd go Strixhaven, Innistrad, D&D, Kaldheim. Mm-hmm. But again, it's like a hair boom, 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 boom.
Yeah, they all really seem pretty awesome. So I am looking forward to visiting all these planes, revisiting these planes. And actually, I really want to see what Wizards comes up with for like the mechanics of the D&D set. My one prediction for this one, Mosh, is I think we might see stuff like potions, which we don't really
see.
I think there's a chance we see a lot of artifacts because so much of D&D is like, we killed a monster, what's the loot? And then the second thing is potions, which might be like a one-time use or something. Like, that might be like a new mechanic.
That's interesting. Like, you can see like underpriced or, you know, some kind of creature that if your opponent kills it, they get something. Flips into something.
Oh, my God. It would be so cool if you could kill stuff and get loot from it.
Yeah, something similar. Yes. So, you know, that would be very, very interesting.
I could see it be the sort of mechanic where, like, the better the creature is, like, you get it really undercosted, but if your opponent's able to kill it, they get pretty good loot. So, like, that's the downside. Mm. The downside is if it dies, they get a good benefit from it.
Yeah, that'd be interesting. So, yeah, I think there's a lot of space to work here. So, I'm looking forward to.
Yeah.
Speaking of kind of revisiting places, there's another kind of revisit, if you will. They announced Time Spiral Remastered. And we started talking about this during the pre-show. And I assumed, just because, look, I'm eyeballs deep in Amonkhet Remastered. I'm like, oh, man, I can't wait to draft this on Arena. And Gabby's like, yeah, it's not on Arena. I'm like, what are you talking about? Like, Time Spiral Remastered. It's going to be, they said it's draftable. It's going to be on Arena. And she was like, no, it's not. And then we Googled this. We started asking people.
We like sent out a bird call to multiple people like, yo, do you know if this is going to be on Arena or not?
So finally, we get a response from Bex. Shout out to Rebecca Worley. And she says, no, I watched the stream. It is just paper, which also, I'm sure that's right. I'm not challenging what Bex said, but that doesn't make any sense to me because all these cards are already, I think, probably 99% of them have to be on Magic Online at this point.
It might still be a draftable set on Magic Online, but I think the specific thing they were referring to is that it's not going to be on Arena. And part of the reason it's not going to be on Arena is because Time Spiral has a lot of nonsense. Like, if they actually put it on Arena, all these cards would end up in Historic, and there's cards that I don't think you want there. Like, no. I don't think you want Path. I don't think you want Chalice of the Void. There's just some nonsense cards that I think don't make sense for that format, especially it being like a smaller card pool format. But it is going to be draftable in paper.
Yeah. And one would assume, even though they say paper only, it's just like, it's so low. It's such low hanging fruit to just put it on Magic Online. Like, you'd have to assume that that's going to be coming. So I'm excited. Time Spiral, you know, you weren't playing when the original Time Spiral
came. No, I'm actually like stoked about this because I feel like Time Spiral is this really big hole I have in my knowledge of Magic history where, you know, I started playing at around M13 a little bit earlier, like Avacyn Restored. And I've played every set since then, obviously. I haven't stopped playing Magic since I started playing Magic. So I've played every set since then, and I feel like I have very good understanding of all those sets. And then I also have a lot of good understanding and lore of previous sets. But Time Spiral, I know, is one of those places that people really love. And I've honestly never even sat down to take a look at the entire, like, card list of what was in it. I know everything in it is, like, a lot of nonsense, but I have always been very jealous of that I didn't get to experience that set.
It was amazing. I actually drafted that the first time out. I don't remember any of the strategy, but I had a good time. I enjoyed it. And of course, we had Tarmogoyf and, you know, not in Time Spiral, but in Future Sight, which is part of the block. Mm-hmm. Really, really interesting, though, because in Time Spiral, again, not Time Spiral, was it Future Sight? Yeah, Future Sight had the extra time shifted stuff, if I recall correctly.
I'm not sure. This predates
maybe
me.
Maybe it was all the way through the block actually where you got the future. I can't remember. Anyway, this there's all these jokes, right, where people say like, hey, Wizards could put a $100 bill in a pack of Magic and people would complain. The time shifted cards could be any rarity. So you could open a pack with the time shifted stuff and get two rares. You get the set rare and then a time shifted rare. It was possible to have packs with two rares. And I'm not joking, Cappy, people went ballistic.
People were mad about that? Why?
You're devaluing the product.
Oh my god, get out.
Wizards
no.
of the Coast is tanking the price of singles in Magic. And it was like literally, you would think, right? People, how could people complain if there were two rares in a pack? Gabby, people can complain if there are two rares in a pack.
Oh my God. Magic players and just complaining about literally everything, name a more iconic duo. It's mm-hmm. any day that ends in Y. It's just always something.
Yeah.
That's really funny.
I remember, because I wasn't working at Superstars. No, it was Channel Fireball. I was working at Channel Fireball at that time. This is before Channel Fireball. This is Superstars. Fangren Firstborn. Is that right? Yeah. I think it was before Super. So I was still practicing law. And I remember talking to Channel Fireball president and CEO John Sasso about this. He's like, Mosh, you'll never believe this. I was like, shut the front door.
I couldn't believe you right now when you were telling me. I'm like, I could have taken a lot of guesses and I would have not gotten to that answer. Yeah, that's really funny.
True. But it was great. There's a lot of nostalgia. A lot of great mm-hmm. old cards come back. And it was awesome. It was a great set. They did a good thing where they preserved the original art, just a new little icon. It was awesome. So I'm really looking forward to Time Trial Remastered.
Yeah.
I wish I could draft it on Arena, but.
You could finally dust off the MTGO and give it a shot. I know the other day I was telling you to play Supreme Draft, I think, and then you were like, I haven't honestly logged into Moto in so long. And someone responded to both of us being like, just stream it. I think it's going to be good content trying to see you figure out how to get to the actual queue.
It's true. You know what? I was going to do it. I was like, you know what? I am going to do it. And then I started talking to you and Luis, and both of you were like, thumbs down on
Supreme Draft. Supreme Draft is big thumbs down. Like, I feel like I am, when it comes to a lot of Magic stuff, I like really try to give the benefit of the doubt. Like you know how some people like play a set one draft and they have like all their hot takes ready. I really kind of hold off on making, because I also think it's so easy that once you've already made up your mind on something, it's just going to have confirmation bias forever. Like you're just going to look for all the reasons why you hate or love the thing. So I usually try to reserve my opinion and, you know, ingest a couple of like opinions of different people. I try it myself for my own opinion and then go from there. Supreme Draft was a bust. I played it enough to realize that I'm just not even going to play it on stream anymore. It just doesn't feel like draft. The joke was interesting for like one draft and then it's done. And it also, I think one of the things that it does is it highlights the problems of the set way more, because you're often seeing all the rares. And so draft self-corrects in some ways, right? You have this busted rare, but then you end up having all these other commons and uncommons. And like if the set generally ends up being underpowered or overpowered, it becomes an average because you end up with the rares and all the other cards that you drafted. When you only draft pack one pickwalking out of every pack, you end up with these like really wonky decks where you're not reading the signals at the table, which I think is a fun thing to do in draft. You're not trying to wheel anything because nothing's coming to you. There's something that I cannot explain about Supreme Draft, which is that picks are timed. Like they're timed.
That makes no sense.
You're drafting by yourself. I don't understand. Mm-hmm. So the picks are timed, and I feel like it makes like the problems of the set even more highlighted, because whatever was the most busted strategy in that format, you can always get it. You're always pack one, pick one-ing.
Mm.
So I big thumbs down. Do not.
Big
I do
thumbs
not.
Down.
Yeah, no, it was not.
All right, we'll not be doing that then. And at this point, you know, I think we've got another week or two of Amonkhet Remastered, and then Zendikar Rising's here, and I'm going to be into that.
Amonkhet Remastered was really fun. I love it. I loved Amonkhet when it was around. I liked it more than most people, I think. I just thought it was a cool set, and I liked the flavor. And they did a really good job with the remastering of it, I think. I think it's cool that they remaster sets, especially for people who didn't get a chance to play them the first time around. I remember playing Tempest Remaster on Magic Online, and it was fun because I never played Tempest, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. It's been a fun ride, and I guess I'm just bummed. Like the idea that Time Spiral Remastered won't be there, because I'm just addicted to Arena. I'm loving it. I'm playing so much Magic, and I'm having a blast.
That's great. I love it. I mean, that was the whole point, right? That was the goal.
They got me back in. For those listening, that sounds like a joke. I literally went to a lane, and I was like, I'm making all this Magic content. We're doing so much with Magic, and I'm still not playing very much, and I want to make it a goal to play. Sometimes on a weekend, she'll just be like, oh, did you want to play Magic today? I'm like, yeah, you know what, baby, I'm gonna do a draft. I'm gonna play a few hours of Magic. You know, and she'll just read on the couch next to me, and I'll do a draft. It's just great. It's just awesome.
That's cute. I like that.
Yeah, I'm loving it. It's amazing. So, well, speaking of draft, we already mentioned that Party was a mechanic in Zendikar Rising. And it's interesting because I think it's a very interesting mechanic, but I think it's really, I don't know. I feel like it feels like more of a draft mechanic than a constructed mechanic, no matter what they do with it.
Yes, I do agree with that. Maybe that's the reason I like it more. I've been lying to myself over the last like year or so that I still play constructed. I really don't. It's just a lie. It's a lie I told myself.
I've never heard you talk about constructed at all. Oh, I'm sorry. We did. They announced Modern Horizons 2. Before we move on, we should just make that.
Oh yeah, that's just very quick. They're doing Modern Horizons 2, hopefully with less busted cards that need all get banned. But generally speaking, Modern Horizons 1 was a very fun draftable set. So assuming that we don't break every format, like that can be a cool thing.
And I think just the idea of printing new cards for Modern is a very good thing. And I feel like Time Spiral Remastered is kind of like a low-key like Modern Masters set.
It does. I feel like it's gonna fill that role. One of the other cool things about Modern Horizons 2 is that they are printing the enemy fetch lands in the draft boosters for it.
Enemy fetches. There you go.
Yeah.
Welcome back.
And they're gonna be rares. So.
Oh, that's good. I mean, they should not be mythic. That would be insane if they were mythic. That would be terrible. Yeah. So. Okay, so then we've got this party mechanic, which we've alluded to quite a bit. And basically, let me see if I get all the classes right. So the party mechanic offers you a benefit if you have one creature for each of these types: a cleric, a warrior, a wizard, and a rogue. Mm-hmm. I believe those are the four.
Yeah, right? You nailed it.
And one of the things that's very interesting is historically when we have, I'll just call them class checks, creature type checks, we can say class check, I think. Changelings check all the boxes. Mm-hmm. That is not the case with the party. There are no parties of one. You have to have, if you want a full party, you have to have one of each type.
So yes, but I think the cards care about different things. Like some cards will care about you having a full party and they will reward you for having one of each. Like some cards will have a really big payoff if you have cleric, rogue, warrior, wizard. But then some cards only care that you have party members. They won't actually ask for specific things. Like say like, if you have a cleric, then this happens. It's like, if you have a party member, then this happens. Or if you have two party members.
Or it's minus one.
Exactly.
+1/+1 for each party member you have. But I think it's capped at four. It's never more than four.
It's the four. Like an example here is Kabira Outrider is the one that they used to showcase the mechanic. And it's a four mana 3/3, a three and a white. That's a human warrior that says when Kabira Outrider enters the battlefield, target creature gets +1/+1 until end of turn for each creature in your party. So it's not looking specifically for a warrior or a wizard. It's looking that you have different creature types. So it also will incentivize people in draft to kind of break off of just doing the exact same archetype, because if you are trying to draft stuff for party, you are very incentivized to try to get a lot of different creature types or classes, I guess.
Yeah, it's the kind of thing that you, I think, can work really, really, really well in draft. Like immediately I see this and it's like, oh my God, this is going to be, you're going to be drafting and be like, okay, so I got a cleric here and this is, and then, oh wait, this is a warrior wizard or a warrior rogue. That's great. It can check both boxes. And you're going to be looking at all your creature types throughout the draft. And that's the kind of stuff that's a lot of fun when you're drafting, trying to keep track of all that. And
totally.
This is, I think everybody's already kind of looking at Zendikar Rising with like, there's going to be the party deck, right? I think that's just going to be a strategy.
Absolutely.
Normally, did you draft Zendikar 1.0? I'm not sure.
That predates
There's
me.
Like aggro landfall. Is like a thing. Like Zendikar, if I remember correctly, was a very aggressive format.
I believe so.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I mean there were cards like Steplinks and stuff. Like Steplinks is hella aggro.
plated Geopede, like that. So I think, I wonder if there's going to be something like an aggro landfall deck in this format.
That I would believe so. I mean, that is actually one of the other mechanics that's returning to Zendikar Rising is landfall. And I actually love landfall, Mashi. Landfall might be my favorite mechanic. I think it's amazing.
Wow, favorite mechanic.
Yeah,
I thought about what mine is. That's crazy.
It's really hard to come up with one, but I mean, it's easily top five for me. The reason I really like it is because it to me, in some ways, it's like such the perfect mechanic because there are very few things that can actually make me feel good about drawing a land later in the game. I think it's one of the worst, like, feels in Magic, right? Like when you're starting the game and you're trying to make your land drops so that you can play your four drop on turn four, like that's exciting to draw land, obviously. But then you get to this late game and you're just like, oh my god, I'm flooding out, and like, did I put too many lands in my deck? Like I can't do anything. If you draft a landfall deck, a lot of times, even when you draw that land in the late game, it can still be exciting because it's like, okay, I have these two creatures, they proc off of landfall, and if that happens, I get to like tap this thing and maybe like nug this other thing, and I still feel like I'm in this game. And it's the same for your opponent. Like, it's actually kind of dangerous because you're like, oh man, like I want them to flood, but oh, they have this landfall creature. It's actually quite bad for me if they landfall. So I love it for that reason. It's one of those things where if you miss out on it, it's not that big a deal because a lot of times you're like playing your land, then play your creature, and it's like, okay, well, I didn't get to trigger it. That's okay. And in the late game, it's like one of the things, that one of the very few things that makes me excited to draw land.
Yeah. I also, speaking of land, they've really gone the extra mile with lands. They have these flip cards. Some are spells on one side of lands or creatures on one side or lands, or these new dual lands, which are insane, I think, right? Where it's like, one land type, they're not land types, but, you know, a blue mana producer on one side, a white mana producer on the other. I'm not sure if that's actually one of the combos. I think it is. But I think those are amazing.
Those are super cool. So basically, if you haven't seen them, it's a flip card, but you get to choose which side you want to play. And it'll be like one color in one side and a different color on the other side. And these come out rare, but there's other uncommon lands that also do something similar. My preview card was the green uncommon land that either comes in tapped as a forest or like comes in tapped to produce green rather. Or the other side is a 1/1 that ramps for one, which is really sweet because it's like a modal card. It's basically a split card. And I love split cards because a lot of times they just give you so many options. Like this can be a land if you need it to boot. But if you want a ramp creature and then you have enough mana, you can easily cast this, you know, like you can easily just cast it as a creature that also ramps. And if you draw it in the late game, it means that you actually have a creature that you can play as opposed to just being like, rats, I got another land.
Yeah, I love it. I think Mana Flood and Mana Screws are some of the big challenges that Wizards R&D, I think, is constantly struggling with. And this is a great way to answer Mana Flood. And it gives you utility, particularly if you're playing an aggro deck. You know, there's a burn spell. It's not a great burn spell, but, you know, hey, would you rather have one damage or your eighth mountain, right? You'd rather have the one damage. Just take it and go.
Right, for sure.
So I think that, you know, that's exciting. And then, Jesus, there's one other, isn't there?
Yeah, there's Kicker. Kicker's a pretty popular mechanic making a comeback. Kicker's cool. Kicker's cool. Kicker also, once again, is a little bit like having a split card. And I think people just generally like having stuff like this because a lot of times it means that you can play a thing early if you need to just like buy yourself some time. But if you get into the late game, it's an awesome mana sink and it gives you a way to like really get the benefit of, you know, drafting a deck or even just like playing a constructed deck that can leverage its mana on every turn. So
can you name the first set with Kicker?
I have no idea. Literally no clue. Do you
know? I think it's invasion. I feel good about invasion.
What is it, Bumpy Pay Grid Mosh?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it was through the whole block. I'm like, mate, what did it start with Plane Shift or Apocalypse? But no, I think it's invasion. Yeah, I'm going to go with invasion. Dismantling Blow, yes, invasion.
Was that it?
Yeah. So, definitely returning favorite. And all you can see in this set, that there's ways where they're, just as you've pointed out, there's ways that they're trying to accommodate late game mana flood or trying to make that stuff more useful. You know, Kicker's exactly that. Having lands that flip into spells or other utility things like is exactly that. So it's a very, very good space for gameplay. And that's awesome. And I'm looking forward to it. And I think it's slowing things down a little bit, which we all needed. So I'm happy.
Yes, I think, it was fun drafting Amonkhet Remastered, but I think I like the slow blocking sets a little bit more. Mush is like, no, all I want is Gus Walker. Attack and exert. Yeah, attack and exert.
Turn him sideways. Turn him sideways. All right. Well, there you have it. That is this week's Magic FM. Thank you for coming along for the ride. This was a fun week.
Yeah, a lot of cool announcements.
Yeah, this is such an exciting, definitely not a Q&A week, a very, very, very exciting week. So thank you for joining us. Don't forget, we do have an affiliate code if you want to support the podcast, Magic FM. You can use that whenever you sign up for CFB Pro or make any purchases on channelfireball.com. Those affiliate codes support this podcast. Let Channel Fireball know that you like the podcast, and that supports both of us. We appreciate it. Thank you very much. You can follow us on Twitter at Magic FM Podcast. I am at Mashi Scanlon across all social media platforms. She is at Gabby Spartz everywhere on social media. You can find her on twitch.tv/Gabby Spartz. You can find the video if you're listening to us on the podcast. Please hit subscribe and check out the video. We have a good time. We have a lot of fun on the video. So check that out on channelfireball.com or on youtube.com. And we look at the comments. So if you have any thoughts, share them with us, and we'd love to hear from you. That does it for this week. We'll be back next week with some more. I think there's a lot more exciting news coming. So I feel good about it. We'll probably cover a little Zendikar Rising. All the spoilers will probably be out more or less by then. So until then, be wonderful to yourselves. Be wonderful to each other.
Bye-bye.